All right, good afternoon. Sorry for the late start. It always takes a while to set up. So let's get started very quickly. Today and indeed this week, the topic is methodology. So how do we approach machine learning experiments? We won't talk specifically about how specific classifiers work or how specific techniques work. We'll just look at the kind of stuff you do to test a certain classifier, or to prepare your data, or to set up a machine learning pipeline. So all of the stuff we talk about this week is very important for your project, because this is the things we want you to do, and the things we want you to keep in mind. So this is a basic machine learning recipe that we've talked about a lot already. And this week we're not going to look at the internals of the recipe, we're going to take the recipe as is, and we are going to look today at what we do once the recipe is finished. So once we have some trained machine learning model, what do we do with it? How do we see if it's any good? And then on Thursday morning, we're going to talk about what we do before we start with the machine learning recipes. How do we set up our data, and how do we make sure that our data is nice and suitable for machine learning? But today, we're going to talk about evaluating your models. So here's the plan. So let's write this down. So first part, we'll start by looking at basically performing an experiment. So what does that look like? What do we do? How do we make sure that the results are reliable? Then we'll go into what exactly do we report? So which numbers we want to measure and which numbers we want to talk about when we talk about the performance of the classifier, about how good a classifier is. We'll do that for classification before the break, and then for regression after the break. We have a lot less to talk about in terms of regression. And we'll also talk a little bit about statistics, so confidence measures, p-values, that kind of thing, whether we use them in machine learning, and if we choose to use them, how. And then finally, if there's time, I have quite a lot of slides, so I hope we'll get to this. I'd like to talk a little bit about the no-free lunch theorem, which is basically the answer to the question, which machine learning model, which method is best in general? So we've seen a few already, decision trees and stuff. Which of these is the best in general? So there's a lot to be said about that, and I'll try and do that very quickly at the end. But first, let's start with the settings. So we'll focus today on binary classification, which is classification of two classes. And in those cases, it helps to think of your classifier as a detector for the positive class. You have two classes, one of them more or less arbitrarily you call positive, and then your classifier is a detector for the positive class. So if you, in medicine, people often talk about testing positive for a certain disease. That's because it's binary classification. You either have the disease or you don't have the disease, and the classifier is a detector for the disease. So that's what we call the positive class. Because of that, the positive class is not usually a positive thing, because usually you want to detect bad things, so it's usually disease, or spam email, or enemy aircraft, or terrorists, or something like that. So positive is not a value judgment, but it just means the thing that you want to detect, and the negative is everything else. And then we will start with two measures that we've seen already. Basically, once you have a classifier, how often does it misclassify something, or what proportion of your data does it misclassify? That's called the error. And the opposite, what proportion of your data does it classify correctly? That's called the accuracy. So that's where we'll start with the things we want to report. And we'll see what the good and the bad things about these measures are. And specifically, when you're reporting errors or accuracies for classifiers, you usually do so to compare models. Because you usually are interested in finding a classifier that is the best for your given task. You want to find a good model, so you want to compare different models. That comes in two flavors. Either you want to compare different types of models, so we've seen three models so far, the linear classifier, the decision tree classifier, and the K-Band classifier. So if you have some data, you might want to, well, think those are the three I know. Let's see which one is best. So you might want to compare those three, but even if you think, well, I'm going to go for the K-nearest neighbor classifier, you still have this K value that you have to choose, which is kind of what we call a hyperparameter, which is a parameter that is not learned, that is not part of the model, but that you have to choose yourself based on your instincts or whatever. So you might want to, within one class of models, you still might want to compare different hyperparameters. So here we see three different K-nearest neighbor classifiers for different values of K. In this case, K3, K9, and K27, from left to right. And you might want to compare those as well. So how do we do that? Let's start with a very simple. If I just told you to do it now, try something, you might come up with a protocol like this. Which is better, classifier A or B. So you train A and you train B. Compute the error for A and you compute the error for B. And then the one with the lowest error is the best. That's a sort of naive way of doing it. And practically, this is not very far from what we normally do. This is the basic approach. You just train some classifiers, compute the error, see which one's best. Except that there are a couple of questions that you have to be careful about. Firstly, on which data do you compare the error? How do you eliminate random effects? So is the error that you're measuring actually due to a fundamental property of the classifier that will carry over to new data? Or is it just randomness? And then is error a good metric, or are there other metrics? Should we look at other metrics to determine whether the classifier is actually better? So we're going to look at all three questions. The answer to the first we've sort of seen already in the first lecture. So if you compute the error of your classifier on your training data, you may get a very, very low error, even though the classifier is not very good. Which is what we see here. This is called overfitting. Basically, the classifier or your regression model is really describing every single detail of the data. And that's not what we want. We want it to generalize. We want it to ignore some of the details of the data, but fit the general image of the data. So if we look at the training set error, we won't see this. The very best model is always the model that overfits. In order to do this, we need to look at some other data. So we never judge our performance on the training data. We judge our performance on withheld data. So first we train the training data, and then we compute the error on the test data. If the error on the test data is good, then we have a model that generalizes well. A little bit more detail about how to separate this if you're given just one big bag of data and you have to separate out your own test data. Don't look at the proportion. Don't go for a 20-80-20 split. Look at the size of your test data. That's the important part. That should be, well, roughly it should be at least 500 instances. But really the ideal that you want to shoot for is 10,000 instances. That's the amount of test data you need. And then whatever you have left over as training data, use that as training data. So then 10,000 can become very expensive because it can leave you with very little training data to work with. So you have to find a balance in here somewhere. But a big test data set can be very important, as we'll see as the lecture continues. But we're not there yet, because it can still go wrong if we are testing lots and lots of models. So to illustrate this, let's try an experiment where we take the data we already saw. This is the data from the first lecture, where we measured the height of people and the distance between the shoulder blades, and we tried to classify whether they're male or female. And let's take a subsample of this data set. So we have a small data set, because that amplifies the effect that I'm talking about. So it's easy to see. So let's say we have a very small data set, and we train a k-nearest neighbor classifier on this. I talked about this in the first lecture. Just to reiterate, the k-nearest neighbor classifier for a new point looks at the k-nearest points and takes them, assigns to that new point the majority class in this k-neighborhood. So there's more blue points in this, the seven nearest points, and red points, so the new point becomes blue according to this classifier. So let's say we're training a k-nearest neighbor classifier on this small data set. And we decide to just test. We have no idea what k should be. So we're just going to test the first 25 values. From 1 to 25, we're going to test all of them and see which one yields the lowest test set error. That looks like this. And as you can see here, for k is 1, you get a very jagged decision boundary. And for k is 25, it becomes almost linear. So we compute the test set error for all of these, and we get this one as the lowest test set error, 0.08. And what I've plotted here is the test set. So you're just looking at the test set and the decision boundary from the classifier trained on the training set applied to the test set. And as you can see, this 0.08 error comes from two misclassified points, one blue point here, one red point here. And all the other points, all the other classifiers had one extra misclassified point at least, which was this one here, which is just on the right, at this for this classifier, just on the right side of the decision boundary. So you might reasonably ask, is that actually, because this is actually a better classifier, or was this one just lucky? Because we tested 25 of them. If there's a little bit of noise in where that decision boundary ends up, it's very reasonable to assume that one of them just got lucky and didn't misclassify this point. So what we can do now, the luxury that you don't normally have, is we can do the same experiment again on new data. Normally at this point, once you've used up your test data, you've used up all your data and you need to make your decision. But since we subsampled a small data set, we can subsample another data set from the same larger data set and rerun the whole experiment on new data from the same source. So let's do that. We get 25 new classifiers. And this time, the best classifier is over here at k is 5, which is very, very different from what we saw earlier. And if we look at this k is 5 classifier up close, what we see is that it's most of its performance comes from getting this area here right. There happen to be just two men in this area, whereas actually we know that the actual relation is linear, so actually this is a big red area. But it just so happens that in this particular sample of our data set, we didn't sample any women in this area, and we did sample two men. And this particular classifier manages to respond to that. Managed to, by luck, manages to have a big blue area here. So these are two runs of the same experiment on the same data, or data from the same source, that produce radically different values for k. Saying in one run we get 23 is best k, in another run we get 5 is best k. In other words, we cannot trust this result because we're overfitting again. Because we're repeatedly, basically this algorithm that we're using of trying classifiers and computing their errors and figuring out the lowest one, that's an algorithm. So it's just another learning algorithm. And it can overfit just like our training algorithm. In this case, we're overfitting on k. Which is an instance of the multiple testing phenomenon that you might know from statistics. And if you know your KCD, XKCD, you'll know this comic that explains it quite well. If you don't, I recommend clicking on this link. Basically, whenever you test something in statistics or machine learning or anything else, there's always a little randomness and a little real signal. And usually you set it up so that the randomness is small enough. In our case, by choosing a big enough test set, we minimize this randomness. But then the more things you test over and over again, the more this randomness blows up again, which is what we're seeing here. And so we're getting results responding to that randomness. So the rule here, basically this is the proper evaluation technique if you're testing more than one comparison. If you're testing hyperparameters and you're testing different models, which you usually are. The idea is, well, first split your data into training and test data, as we've already seen. But then, when you're choosing your model and you're choosing your hyperparameters and you're doing all your research, your open-ended research, figuring out what you're dealing with, looking at your data, all this stuff, you don't look at your test set. Whatever you do, you can more or less figure that out yourself, but you do it only on the training set. Then when your project is finished, you have some conclusions that you think are true. You state those conclusions as a hypothesis. So you say, I think that a K&N classifier with KS7 is the best for this data. And then you test your hypothesis once on the test data. So you look at your test data only once. Here, just to really drive home the point, don't reuse your test data. And that's the reason I want to emphasize that so much is that it really requires you to think about this at the start of your project. So once you get some data, you have to immediately, before you do anything else, split it into some test data and some training data, leave your test data alone, and never look at it again until the end of your project. Because once you've looked at it and used it to draw some conclusions, you can't unlook at it. It's an irreversible project, a process. So you can unlook at your data. So you need to be a bit disciplined about this, and you need to know when the start and when the end of your project are. And there's, just to make it precise, what happens when you do reuse your data, two things happen. First, it causes you to pick the wrong model, as we saw. In this, especially in the second example, we picked KS5, when KS5 actually wasn't a very good model. But also, it inflates your performance estimates. So both of these models had performance of 0.08. But part of that was by luck. So if we say, we take this model, we give it to somebody else, and we say it gets a performance of 0.08, it misclassifies only 8% of your training examples, that person will be disappointed when they actually try it, because it will turn out that the model performs much worse on their data because of this randomness. So we don't reuse the test data, we only look at the training data. So how do we now, without evaluating on our training data, how do we actually pick these hyperparameters? Basically by splitting our training data again into a training and a validation set. So we just split off a test set, we split off a validation set, and then when we're testing hyperparameters, when we're testing models and we're designing our model, we train on a training and we test on a validation set, and then when we're done and we think, okay, now we have our conclusions, we have our hypothesis, and we think this is true, then we can train again on the whole combination of training and validation set, training and validation data, and test once on a test set. Just to show you what it looks like when people get this wrong, because people do get this wrong a lot, and when you're reading machine learning papers, it helps to interpret them properly. And if that happens, you will see something like this. So this is a table of results. I've made up these numbers, so don't look at them too closely. But you might see something like, this is what some other method got, and some other method got, and this is what our methods got, four different hyperparameter values. And these are the error rates for three different data sets. And then you make the best values bold and you show, well, all the best values are for our method, so our method is best. And that's the result. But what they're doing here is they're reusing, they're basically testing different versions of their model, different hyperparameters, and reusing their test set for each one of them. So what they should have done is this. Choose your hyperparameter on the validation set for each model. So for each model, you get a different hyperparameter, which you may or may not report, depending on whether it's relevant. And you get one, for that specific hyperparameter, you get one error value, and you report that error value. I've changed the numbers a little bit to show that they will become a little bit worse. But basically, if you see this, basically this kind of table falsely implies three conclusions. Namely, that the authors have a better model than the other methods, which is not true because they have this overfitting problem. But if you run the model on dataset 1, you should use K3, which is not true because they've overused their test set, so they may have picked the wrong model. And that if you have a dataset that is similar to dataset 1, you can roughly expect an error of 0.08, and that's also not true because they've inflated their performance. Whereas if you look at this table, you can actually conclude those things. So you can say, well, at least for dataset 3, it looks like this is the better model. And there you can roughly expect a performance of 0.25%. 0.25, sorry. And if we have this kind of data, then K is two is the best model to use. It's the best hyperparameter to use for K. It's the best value to use for the hyperparameter K. Sorry. One drawback of this this idea is that it may leave you with very little training data. If you first split off a test set, then you split off a validation set, you may not have a lot of training data left over. In that case, you can use something called cross-validation, which works like this. You basically do multiple runs of your experiment, and you split your data set in five chunks. And for every run, one of those chunks becomes your validation set, and the rest becomes your training data. Then after you've computed the error for all of them, you average it, and that becomes your estimate for the error. And this basically allows you to use every element in your training data once as a training example, but still have a training validation split. So this is very good if you have little training data left over. It is a little bit more expensive because you have to repeat everything five times. So then you might ask, how do we actually pick these hyperparameters? You can do what I just did, try everything, try basically every value in a certain range. If you have multiple hyperparameters, that becomes expensive. Basically, there's not one specific thing that you absolutely have to do. Once you've set it up like this, once you've set up your training and your test split and your validation data, you're free to use whatever intuition you like. You can use anything you like, and you can use your intuition, or you can use a fixed method to get good results. So intuition, trial and error, that's fine. You can just try some values and see if you can come up with a good one. If you want to be a bit more rigorous, and if you have a bit more computing power available, you can do a grid search, which is basically, if I have one hyperparameter here, K, of three values, and one hyperparameter here, call it H, you just pick three values that seem right, two values here, and you just try all combinations of both. That's why it's called a grid search. And the specific values that you're trying depend on the type of hyperparameter. So if your hyperparameter is K, as in K nearest neighbor, you may want to try something like 2, 5, 12 or something. So a linear scale of the integers. And if your hyperparameter is something like a learning rate, then you might want to try something like 0.001. 0.001, 0.01, and so on. So that depends entirely on what kind of hyperparameter you're dealing with, what appropriate values are. But this blows up exponentially, as you can imagine, the number of trials. So sometimes that doesn't work. You can do what's called one factor at a time. So you first try all the learning rates for one particular value of K. And then once you have the best one, you try all values of H for one particular for that value of K, for the best value of K, and so on. And you can even go all out and do stuff like random search that we talked about last week. And it applies basically to this problem as well. But that can be very expensive. And quite often, simple trial and error is good enough. So that's how you find your hyperparameters, how you find your good model to train, and then you get some error. So then you have to ask yourself, the error value that you get, is it any good? Right? Let's say somebody comes to you, a fellow student, and says to you, I have a really nice machine learning project, and I got an error of 0.05. Should you be impressed by that? And the answer to that is, it depends. It depends entirely on the problem whether an error of 0.05 is good. So let's look at a specific example to illustrate this. This is a question that comes back in the Dutch media quite often and international media as well. I saw an article on the BBC website about this today. Breast cancer screening. So should women over 50 be should we recommend that all women over 50 are regularly screened for breast cancer? Might seem like a very simple answer because breast cancer is such a horrible disease, obviously. The more people who screen, the better, right? The problem is that a screening like this is basically a classifier. Something you, some features go in, and it tells you you either have cancer or you don't have cancer. But in both cases, it can be wrong. And this kind of misclassification, getting it wrong, comes with a cost. It's a very high cost if you miss somebody who does have cancer and you tell them they don't have cancer. But there is also a cost if you get it wrong the other way around. If you tell somebody that they have cancer and they turn out to be do not have cancer, there is a very they go into a very invasive screening process. They get biopsies. They get a lot of stress, and that does have a cost. The cost is lower, but it does have a cost. So you have to weigh these things against each other, and you have to weigh them against the accuracy of the classifier. So these are two. There are two problems here. There are two issues to consider: the class imbalance and the cost imbalance. Let's start with the class imbalance. So the cost imbalance is what I just talked about. There's two ways of making mistakes, and they don't come with the same cost. But the cost isn't zero for either of them. There's also the class imbalance, which looks like this. This is a highly imbalanced class, not quite as imbalanced as the breast cancer example. But if your data, sometimes your data set looks like this. So you get lots and lots of positive examples, sorry, lots and lots of negative examples. Other labels are wrong. But lots and lots of negative examples and lots, very few positive examples. And in this case, this really affects what your accuracy means. So if I have a data set like this, and I get an error of 0.05%, that's the same error as I would get if I just classified everything as red in this picture. I would also get 5% error. So that's what's called a majority class baseline. So in the breast cancer example, it's equivalent to just classifying everybody you see in your screening as healthy, as not having cancer. And in that example, if you do that, you get an accuracy of 1%, of 1%. So that's very simple. It's called a baseline, a very simple approach. It's not meant to be used as a serious production system, but it sort of calibrates your error values that you're interested in. So when you're talking about breast cancer screening, and you ask what's a good score to get in a classifier for breast cancer screening, anything above 1% is completely meaningless, because you might as well just call everybody healthy and you get the same score, you get the same results. So the only real values that you're interested in for error rates are between 0 and 0.01. Or in this example, 0 and 0.05. So that's an example of a baseline. A very, very simple method that is not meant as a serious solution to your problem, but it helps you calibrate what kind of error values are relevant for your problem. And the majority class classifier, the one that just assigns whatever the majority class is a very important baseline you should always look at. You don't actually have to compute it, because you can just get it from the class distribution, what the error rate is. It also means that you don't normally, in those cases, if you have this kind of class imbalance, you don't normally want to look at accuracy or error, because the relevant accuracy and error rates are so small that it's very difficult to get a good judgment. And there's some better metrics that you can use that we're going to look at later that you can use instead. But we'll come to that later. Another problem that you get when you have class imbalance is illustrated here. So basically, if you start with 10,000 instances, you might think, hey, I'm in pretty good shape. I have 10,000 instances in my data. That's a pretty decent amount of data. Then if you split off a test set of 1,000 instances, you end up with just 50 positive instances in your test set and just 250 positive instances in your data, your training data. That doesn't make sense. I made a mistake somewhere, but it's 50 instances in your test set. I guess it should be. The 50 is correct anyway. And the point is, you're really only looking at how many of these you get right, especially if you look at accuracy and error. Really, you just have 50 different values of performance that you can even distinguish between your models. So it may look like you have a very accurate way of distinguishing stuff because you have 1,000 test set instances and you have values like 99.93%. But really, you just have 50 different flavors of model that make any difference. So in this case, what you actually want to do, the first thing, is make your test set bigger. Because it's a lot easier to deal with class imbalance in your training set than it is to deal with class imbalance in your test set. The other thing, cost imbalance, I talked about a little bit already. So you have different types of misclassifications, and they lead to different costs. So I talked about disease diagnosis already, but you have the same thing in like spam classification. If I diagnose something as spam that isn't spam, I'm deleting somebody's email, which is very bad. If I'm diagnosing something as ham that is actually spam, I'm showing somebody an annoying email, which is also a cost, but it's much less of a cost. So I'd much rather make one type of mistake than the other type of mistake. Same thing goes for financial fraud, and it's really a sort of domain-specific function. So that's what I wanted to say about performing an experiment. So now let's talk about what to report. What kind of metrics can you report, specifically instead of this accuracy and error? So that hopefully you can get a bit more fine-grained views of which models perform well. Specifically in relation to this class imbalance and in relation to this cost imbalance. The first thing to do, so these are the ones I'm going to talk about. So you can keep track. Some of them will have to move beyond the break probably. So start with the confusion matrix, true positive rate, false positive rate, RC plot, clean recall, and then area under the curve and coverage matrix. So these are fairly simple metrics that you can compute on a single classifier. And these ones will need a little bit more time because they're sort of functions that you compute on a collection of classifiers. But I'll talk about what that means later. So let's start with the confusion matrix, which is not a single value, but a bunch of values, four values in the case of a binary classifier. It basically means just you have some actual value of each instance, whether it's positive or negative, and a predicted value, whether you said it was positive or negative, and you just tally up how much of these four possibilities happened for each. So if you get something positive, if something was actually positive and you classify it right, you increment this by one. And if it was actually negative, but you classify it as positive, you increment this by one, and so on and so forth. So for this data set, this is a confusion matrix. And already you can see this splits out for you the different types of the two different ways you can get it right and the two different ways you can get it wrong. So on the green diagonal are the two different ways you can get it right. On the red diagonal are the two different ways you can get it wrong. So if there's a big cost imbalance, this already helps a lot to just plot your confusion matrix and figure out whether this sort of corresponds to the kind of thing you'd like to see. You can also compute the margins. So the margins are very meaningful as well. So if you just sum this, you get the actual number of positives here and the actual number of negatives here. Here you get the predicted number of positives and negatives, which allows you to see if the class distribution that your classifier has uses corresponds to the actual class distribution, which is something you also want normally. And if you have a very strong class imbalance, you might see something like this. So this is the confusion matrix of a majority class baseline on a data set with very high class imbalance. So you can see here it has lots of positive points and a few negative points. And the majority class classifier just classifies everything as positive and gets very high accuracy, but you get zeros here, and that allows you to see that you're not actually doing anything very interesting. And from the confusion matrix, this confusion matrix is very useful, but it's not a single number, so we can't use it to rank. If we have 100 different classifiers, we can't look at the confusion matrix for every one of them and keep that in our mind. We need a single number to rank all of them. So from the confusion matrix, we'd like to derive as many single numbers. We'd like to derive single numbers that we can use to determine which classifier is best. And there's a couple of options. So we've seen the accuracy already. You can also derive that from the confusion matrix. Just sum up the green diagonal and divide it by the total. But we're interested in other measures. So these are two very good ones, the true positive rate and the false positive rate. So the true positive rate is how many true positives you got over how many positives there actually were. And the false positive rate is how many false positives you got over the number of negatives there actually were. So basically how many of the true positives you found versus how many of the actual positives you found versus how many of the actual negatives you misclassified. So as you get more and more eager to classify things as positive, your true positive rate will go up, but your false positive rate will also go up. And you can plot these against each other in an RFC space. So if you put the true positive rate of a classifier on one axis and the false positive rate on the classifier on the other axis, you get a plot which is known as an ROC plot. ROC stands for receiver operating characteristic. You don't really need to know why. It's sort of a historical artifact. It comes from, I think, World War II. It just happens to be what we call it. Like so many things in machine learning, it just has a weird name. In any case, every classifier you're looking at becomes a dot in this space because every classifier has a true positive rate and a false positive rate. So the orange points are ones that are always easy to achieve. So if we classify nothing as positive, then our true positive rate is zero. We classify nothing as positive. We classify nothing accurately as positive. So that's very bad, but our false positive rate is very good because we also don't misclassify anything as positive. And on the other end, we have another orange point where we correctly classify all the positives, but we also incorrectly misclassify all the negatives. And then somewhere in between are the useful classifiers. The thing about these two axes, if you have two objectives that you both want to satisfy as well as possible, basically what you get some classifiers that you cannot really judge which one is better. Like these two green classifiers, which of those is better depends on the cost of misclassification. It depends on whether you would rather have an extra true positive or one fewer false positive. It just depends on your domain and your preferences. But the blue classifier is always worse than either of the green classifiers because it always has a worse false positive rate and a worse true positive rate than both of the green ones. So at least it allows you to diminish some of them. We'll come back to the ROC space later, but first, let's talk about some other metrics that are useful, the precision and the recall. So the precision, let me say this right, precision and recall are both about the true positives. So it's how many of the precision is how many of the proportion of the actual positives that you found. And the recall is the proportion of the things that you classified as positive that were actually correct. There was a very handy diagram on Wikipedia. I always forget which one is precision, which one is recall, and what the definitions are. So probably you will as well. If you do, you can just go to Wikipedia for precision and recall the article, and you'll see this lovely diagram where we see the space of all instances. We've selected some of them, this circle, to be positives. Some of those were correct, the true positives. Some of those were incorrect, the false positives. Precision is this ratio, and recall is that ratio. So that's just how to do it. And again, you can do the same thing you did with the ROC space. We can plot this in a system of axes as well, and then we get, instead of an ROC curve, we get a precision recall curve. But it works very well. It works in the same way, I mean. Let's see, let's push on a little bit. So if you look back to this ROC space, and you imagine if we had, now imagine if we had a single classifier, but which had a sort of dial that we could turn, a dial that could allow us to make it more eager or less eager to determine things as positive. So if we set it all the way to one side, the classifier is very, very careful and classifies nothing as positive. It says, I want to be absolutely certain that I have no false positives, so I'm just going to end up here. And as we increase the dial, it looks at some of the instances and thinks, okay, well, this one I am super certain about that it's positive. So this one I'm going to classify as positive, but the rest I'm going to do just keep the negative. So you end up maybe somewhere here. If that one was actually correct, your true positive rate goes up by one, and you don't pay in your false negative rate, false positive rate. And then if you turn the dial a little bit, it's going to classify more and more things as positive. And it's going to pay by having some false positives. And so on until you turn the dial all the way and it becomes super eager to classify things as positive, so eager that it classifies basically everything as positive. And it does catch all the positives, all the true positives, but it also pays with having a very high false positive rate. And then, obviously, in the end, it just ends up classifying everything as positive. So, if you could do this, if you could get this kind of dial in a classifier, then you get this curve. For a single classifier, you get this curve in ROC space, and you could then afterwards decide for yourself where you want to set this dial. Based on your cost imbalance and your class imbalance, you can sort of decide where you, well, the class imbalance determines the shape of the curve, and the cost imbalance determines which of these, where on the curve you actually want to be. And you can draw the curves for different kinds of these classifiers, and hopefully you can see that one of them is better than the other by the shape of this curve. The problem is you need to have this dial. You need to, for a single classifier, you need to be able to change its behavior to be more or less careful about classifying things as positives. And that's what we call a ranking classifier, a classifier that doesn't just classify things as positive or negative, but actually classifies how much it thinks something is positive. It ranks all your instances by positiveness. And I think that's a good place to put the break. So I say let's take 15 minutes, take a break in 15 minutes, and then after the break we'll talk about how to build a normal classifier into a ranking classifier. All right, let's get started again, find your seat. So this is where we left off. We have this ROC space, and what we were thinking about was figuring out how to make a classifier that doesn't just give us one classification, but that has a little sensitivity dial that we can use to tune how likely it is to classify something as positive. And in order to do that, we need to create a classifier that gives us a ranking instead of just a classification. And there are lots of different ways to do this depending on what classifier you have. So for every classifier, there's a different way of turning it into a ranking classifier. And we'll start with the linear classifier. I'll show you how to do it for a linear classifier and decision tree classifier. And for other ones, you can sort of look up what the standard way of doing it is, or trust that sklearn has implemented it correctly. Usually you don't have to do this yourself. So basically, a linear classifier gives us a line as a decision boundary or a hyperplane. And what we do, we have two directions. We have the blue direction and the red direction. And we just look at the distance between the instance and the hyperplane at the decision boundary, which is a distance is always defined orthogonally, so the distance in a straight angle. And we look how big is that distance. And the bigger that distance is towards the red area, the more negative we consider it. So now we can rank our points, as I've done here, from most negative to most positive. And this is the boundary. This is where the normal classifier puts the boundary. But really, we can now shift this classification boundary from left to right, depending on how many positives we want in this data set, how eager we want to make the data set, sorry, how eager we want to make the classifier to classify something as positive. So we can analyze how good this ranking is by looking at the, before we move back to the RRC space, we can actually look at how good this ranking is. So we can judge a classifier on its ranking, on the ranking it's produced. But we can't do that perfectly, because even though we've now created a ranking classifier, our test set doesn't give us a ranking. It tells us whether something is positive or negative, but it doesn't tell us these two negatives, this one negative is more negative than the other. All we have is labels, not rankings. So the only thing we can judge is for each positive and negative pair, whether they are ranked the right way around. So for two red numbers, we don't know whether they're ranked the right way around. But for every blue and every red, we know whether they're ranked the right way around or the wrong way around. And this pair, the T and the F, are the wrong way around. Because the F is red, but its rank is more positive than the T. And that's a ranking error. So that's one ranking error for this classifier. And as you can see, and that's important to realize, that a ranking error doesn't refer to a single instance, but refers to a pair of instances. So D actually has multiple ranking errors. D also has a ranking error with C, and with E, and with G. Because all those pairs are pairs of points that are the wrong way around. And we can visualize this by taking all the red pairs and all the blue pairs and putting them in a matrix. It gives us a matrix of all possible pairs. So every square in this matrix is one possible pair between a blue and a red point. And if this pair is ranked the right way around, we color it green. And if it's ranked the wrong way around, we color it red. And you have to order the pairs in the right way. So you have to order them according to how negative the classifier says they are. So the classifier says G is the most positive, so that ends up on the left. And Y is the most positive, so that ends up bottom left. And then you get this kind of shape as your coverage matrix. That's called a coverage matrix. And from the coverage matrix, you can determine the false positive rate and the false negative rate at different points along this line right with the threshold. So if I put the threshold over here, I classify everything as negative, because everything to the left of the threshold is classified as negative, everything to the right is classified as positive. So this is one of those baseline classifiers that classifies as everything is positive, and my true positive rate is zero, and my false positive rate is also zero. And then as I move to the left, so I'm looking for the points where there's a red and a blue point next to each other. So as I move to the left, I get the one that I'm super sure about, that it's a positive Y. I classify that as positive, but nothing else. So my true positive rate goes up by one, and my false positive rate stays zero. So that's great. Then if I move further to the right, further to the left, I do get some false positives. So this G is one false positive that I have to accept in order to get these true positives. But it's still one false positive against a lot of true positives. And if I move even further, you get this pattern until this T, where I get to the maximum true positive rate and still have not a full false positive rate. And then after that, I get the baseline classifier again. So this gives us this ranking classifier that traces out a curve through this ROC space. If you have two points in ROC space, you don't really need to worry about the points in between. So if you draw a line between two points in ROC space, what you can do is you can do a random mixture of these two models. So you basically, if you flip a coin and decide to trust either this model or this model, then the resulting false positive rate and true positive rate over your test data will be halfway in the middle. If this coin is unfair, so you trust this one a bit more often than this one, then it moves a little bit to this one. But basically, any classifier on this line, any FPR or TPR on this line, you can achieve. So even though you have these fixed points in space, you can just think of the convex combination of each of these two points as also possible, also within your range. So basically, the whole curve is feasible classifiers, and the area under the curve is a good indication of how good you're doing. Because the more you're up in this corner here, the better you're doing. So the closer your curve comes to this bit, the better your classifier, independent of what your cost imbalance is. So now we have a metric that sort of averages over all possible cost imbalances. So you just compute this, the area under the curve, and that gives you a single number that expresses how well you're doing, independent in some sense of cost imbalance. And if you want to interpret this area under the curve, it's a little bit difficult to interpret, but remember, we're basically just normal taking this coverage matrix and normalizing it to the ROC space. So what you're really, for large data sets, the difference between this curve and this green area, they disappear. And really, what you're estimating is the probability that if you pick a random pair, i.e. a random cell in this matrix, you end up in the green bit. So the probability that a random positive and negative pair in your test set do not make a ranking error together, that's the area under the curve. Which gives you some, hopefully, something to hold on to when you interpret area under the curve. Of course, it doesn't... What we've said so far only applies to linear classifiers. If you have a different classifier, you need a different way to figure out how to turn it into a ranking classifier. So let's look at one more example. The decision tree classifier. I still haven't told you how to train a decision tree classifier, but we do know how it works. So let's just take this model as given and let's evaluate how well the model works without worrying about how to train, how to actually get this kind of model. And as we saw before, it splits your data into segments. Every leaf in your decision tree becomes one of these rectangles in your instance space. And it's those segments that you worry about when you're designing a ranking from a decision tree classifier. Basically, you look at the segment every point has ended up in, and you look at the proportion of red versus blue in that segment. And then you order the points by how red or how blue their segment was. So B is a segment by itself, so it has a purely red segment. So that's the most negative example. And Y is in a very blue segment with all these others, so it becomes a very positive instance. And as you can see now, we have a ranking, but we do have a kind of partial ordering because some instances are ranked as the same amount of negative or the same amount of positive. But still, we have a ranking, so we can move this decision threshold. We can do the same thing again, draw a coverage matrix. The only thing we get now sometimes with the coverage matrix is that two points are ranked as the same. So G should be ranked as more negative than Y, but it's ranked as the same as Y, so we color it yellow instead of green or red. Where did these segments come from is the question. Basically, if you look at the decision tree classifier, at every node, it asks you one question about a feature. So here it says, is the feature height bigger or smaller than 163? And if it is, then go to the right. If it isn't, go to the left. So what you're ending up with is drawing this line here, and you end up in this side and this side, and you get another split. So you end up in either this side or this side, or this side and this side, right? So that's what's called a segmenting classifier or grouping classifier, which basically draws segments in your instance space and classifies every segment, every instance in every segment in the same way. So that gives us AUC. So just to reiterate a few important points, we have the confusion matrix and then all these metrics that we derive from it, precision, recall, positive, false positive rate, true positive rate, etc. These are all metrics for a single classifier. And we saw AUC and the coverage matrix, and those are metrics for a collection of classifiers, specifically usually for the collection of ranking classifiers or the
collection of classifiers derived by creating a ranking classifier and tuning the sensitivity. And how to turn a classifier into a ranking classifier depends on what kind of classifier you're dealing with. Practically, usually, this is done for you. So if you go to sklearn and you try and plot the ROC curve for a given classifier, sklearn will just deal with it for you. But it's good to know what happens under the hood. NAUC is good to use if we have strong cost imbalance or strong class imbalance, but we don't know how to weigh the types of misclassifications. If we don't know that misclassification X costs us 10 times as much as misclassification Y, then it's good to draw these curves and to look at the AUC. Of course, I made all these slides and I looked at all this stuff, and then I remembered this tweet that I saw earlier, which tells you that in many cases, a precision recall curve is actually much better than an ROC curve. So you live and learn. Maybe next year I'll talk about precision recall curves instead of ROC curves. For now, it doesn't really matter much because it doesn't cost you that much to plot both of them in a scalar or whatever package you're using. Sometimes the ROC curves are better, so I would just start by plotting both for a number of classifiers and seeing which one gives you the most distinctive curves. But sometimes you may want to go for a precision recall curve instead of an ROC curve. And then you have to figure out in the end how to actually set this threshold, and that depends mostly on your domain. You have to figure out these costs of these misclassifications, and that's domain specific, so I can't really help you very much there. That's where the break was supposed to happen. So we've talked about what to report for classification. And the next thing, which should be a little shorter, is what to report for regression. And there's not as much to say, but there's a similar sort of trade-off. So this trade-off between two values that we want to achieve, and there's a similar sort of trade-off in regression. That's worth talking about. First one minor point is that we usually use this mean squared error to optimize. But when you're actually reporting, it's quite good to take the square root of that, because it keeps your units the same. Basically, when you're here, you're squaring this difference, and then when you're actually reporting, it's good to take the square root of that to get rid of that square, as it were, because that keeps the units of your error rate the same. So if you're reporting doing regression over something in centimeters, then this has the unit squared centimeters, which is difficult to interpret, and this has the unit centimeters. So your errors will be a little bit more easy to interpret if you take the square root, but only do that when you're reporting. You don't do that as part of the loss function, because then you have this square root in place and you have to differentiate through that. It makes it just more difficult and more numerically unstable. So you can use this to search for a good model, but then use this to evaluate how well that model actually worked. But more importantly, I want to talk to you about bias and variance. So let's say we have a regression model. We've done the same thing here. This training test data, validation data that applies to all machine learning experiments, including regression. So we've split our data into a test set and a training set. We've split our training set again into a training set and a validation set. We've done some experiment, and we've measured some mean squared error on this regression model. So let's think a little bit about what that means and how we can think about this error. So I've drawn it here on an axis. Here's this 0 point, which of course is the ideal mean squared error. That's when all these guys are the same. And it really doesn't matter whether you square them or not. This is 0 for your whole data set, and then the whole thing becomes 0. And a little bit above that is the optimal mean squared error, the best thing you can do. Any guesses why it isn't at 0, why the optimum isn't usually at 0? Yes, I don't know who said it, but yes, because of randomness. So your model,
basically what you're trying to model is the process that actually generated your data, that actually looked at your features and generated an output value. And that model might be partially random. So that model might include some sort of internal coin flip, which means there's some part of it that you cannot predict perfectly because it's random. So there's an irreducible error that even the best model in the world is not going to get rid of. And then that's your optimal mean squared error. And normally you do only one experiment, right? You have one data set, so you do only one experiment and you get one measurement for your NSE. But we can think about what would happen if you were to go through the whole process of resampling your data, getting another data set from exactly the same source. And if you did that, you would get some more values. You go through the exact same process and you get some other measured NSEs. So if you do redo the whole process, or if you find yourself in a different universe where just the randomness worked out a different way, you got a different sample, you might have got a much better MSE because of all the randomness in your process, randomness in the data sampling. There's a certain variance in the output of your experiment, right? And now we can split up our error in two values, or three values, actually. Right, so sorry, I've skipped one step. So the average of that is the true mean squared error. The average of all these hypothetical experiments that you didn't do is the true mean squared error, the mean squared error that you would get if you did lots and lots and lots of experiments and then averaged the result, which you can't do because you have only one data set, but if you could do, then you would get this. And the bias of your experiment is the distance between the optimal mean squared error and this true mean squared error, which we don't know, which is a value we cannot observe directly. And then the variance is basically the variance of these hypothetical mean squared errors around the true mean. And then there's an irreducible error. So these are the three factors that together make up the mean squared error that you observe. And even though we can measure the variance usually, or measure the bias, or separate them, we can think about what it looks like if you have an experiment with low bias and low variance. So then you're very close to the mean squared error. And if you repeat the experiment, you get a very similar result. That's a very good situation. And then it can go wrong in two ways. You can have a low bias but a very high variance, which means that if you average lots and lots of trials on your resampled data, you would still get a very good result. But purely through randomness, you will probably end up here anyway. Because there's such a high variance that this randomness will just push you away anyway. Or you can have the opposite, which is low variance. So you repeat the experiment lots and lots of times, you get exact same result. But that result is crap. That can also happen. Here's a picture you will see often. It's a cardboard metaphor, basically, with high bias or high variance. It's the same thing, except in normally our in our case, it's not a 2D, but a 1D kind of dartboard. But basically, this is a nice illustration of high bias versus high variance. This is usually, the reason we talk about this a lot is because it's a trade-off. You can usually choose high bias at the cost of your variance, or you can choose to lower your bias at the cost of your variance, or the other way around. The high bias models are usually those ones that don't fit the generating distribution. So your generating model has a kind of shape like this curve here, but the model space that you're using, like linear space, doesn't fit. It doesn't have this kind of shape in it, so you get an awkward fit. And if you repeat the experiment again and again and again, you will always get the same line with the linear model, but it will always be a poor fit. So it's a high bias model. And a high variance model is a kind of model like a decision tree where you always get a perfect fit on your data. But it's kind of a too perfect fit. So these models that have a tendency to overfit, you'll get a very low bias. So the ideal model is there. It's there in your model class. The model can approximate the data very easily, but it's very sensitive to small fluctuations in your data. So if you apply this model to a new sample from your data, it's very unlikely that you will see this point here. But still, the model has said, I'm absolutely sure that if your input is 180, then the output should be here. So the model, it has this overfitting
sensitivity to random fluctuations. That's high variance. We don't usually have this nice dial that we saw with classifiers that allows us to make this trade-off, but we can usually make the trade-off in some way by being a bit smart. So if you want to reduce bias, you can increase your model capacity. Some models allow that. Like neural networks, you can just increase their capacity or increase the number of features. We'll see next week, next lecture how to do that. And if you want to reduce the variance, you can reduce the model capacity, of course, get closer to that kind of linear model. And regularization, which we'll talk about later, or if you're doing a tree classifier, you can reduce the tree depth, which will also reduce your model capacity. And for some very rare classifiers, you do actually get the dial. So if you look at a KNN regression in this case, but the same holds for the classifier, what you see is that for a small k, you get this high variance model. And if you increase the k, it sort of graduates towards almost a kind of linear model. The decision boundary becomes almost linear, so it becomes a kind of high bias model. So usually this is the trade-off that you're making when you're choosing a model. And in week 5, we will come back to this when we'll talk about ensembling, which is a method of combining different models, training different models, and then combining them in the hopes of both reducing variance and bias. But that happened next week. So how long do I have left? 20 minutes. So I have half of this section finished, because one thing I'd like to talk to you about finally, before we move to the end of the year, is statistics, which is kind of a difficult subject to talk about in machine learning, because machine learning researchers don't really like statistics, which is odd, because it's basically the same thing, machine learning and statistics. This is a very interesting paper, if you're interested in this sort of thing, about the difference between the two cultures and how they approach a problem, where basically what he states is machine learning researchers, they tend to model the world, and really they're only satisfied if they if the model that they have of their data really matches the generating distribution. Whereas machine learning people, they tend to not really care about what actually happened, they just want a model that works well on the given data, and whether or not it actually captures what happens doesn't really matter. Not sure if this is still completely true, but this was certainly true in 1997 when Leon Brimon wrote this paper. But really what I want to talk to you about here is when we report the results of an experiment, should we use traditional statistical methods? So if we have these two accuracies and we want to say, well, model one has a better accuracy than model two, why don't we just do a certain t-test or something, compute some p-values, if we are so worried about this randomness. So that's basically the question that statistics tries to answer. Can the observed result be attributed to real characteristics of the model under scrutiny, or are they observed by chance? So we're talking now about reporting results over machine learning experiments. Should we use typical statistical hypothesis testing or confidence intervals or stuff like that? And what you see is that it's not that popular in machine learning for different reasons. Good reasons and bad reasons. So it makes machine learning experiments more difficult. There's lots of disagreement about how to do it, about how to interpret it, and about how effective it is. People overestimate the value of statistical analysis, so you add lots of statistics and people will overestimate the results and become less skeptical of it. It doesn't tend to promote, some people say it doesn't tend to promote the best methods. And the ultimate value of research, or the ultimate, how do I put it, validation of research, is not in whether it has a good statistical analysis, but whether it can be replicated. And in machine learning and in computer science in general, things are easy to replicate. If it's set up properly, I can just download a Docker image and rerun the experiment with a single click. So some people argue that we shouldn't focus on statistics, we should focus on ease of replication. I'm not going to tell you what's right or what's wrong. I'm just saying, since this is such an open question in our community as machine learning researchers, we're not going to expect you in your reports to do
of statistics, even though most of you will have taken a statistics course. It's kind of an open question in machine learning, so it would be unfair for me to expect lots of t-tests and confidence intervals and stuff like that from you. Nevertheless, I would just want to look at a couple of statistical methods very quickly. And I'll start with error bars. There's one thing that I think everybody should know or should have come across at least once about error bars, so I'll ask you the question here. So let's say you're reading a research paper and you see some results with some error bars. There's a method A, B, and C, and we're measuring the runtime. Could be anything, but let's say we're measuring the runtime and you see some error bars. But what do these error bars indicate? So the bars are the mean runtime over a number of samples. What value is used for the error bars? It's a trick question, so it's good to be hesitant. But what might it mean? Let's ask it like that one. That's not a trick question. What could be indicated by the error bars? A confidence interval. Any other suggestions? Standard error. One more. All right, well, I'll move on. So there's three common values. Standard error, confidence interval, and standard deviation. The most important thing to realize is that if you see this in a paper and the authors have not stated what the error bars indicate, then the authors have screwed up. So you don't draw an error bar without saying what it means, because it can mean different things. And standard error and confidence interval are quite related, but standard deviation is fundamentally different. So if we have a small data set, let's say these are our runtimes that we've measured. If we have a small data set and we plot these standard deviations and standard errors, the difference becomes apparent if we sample a larger data set. You can see what happens to the confidence interval and the standard error, they become smaller because they measure the confidence in our average. We have a mean here and we have a certain amount of confidence about how confident we are that that mean is correct. And the confidence interval and the standard error tell us how confident we are. So the smaller the confidence interval, the smaller the mean, the better. The standard deviation measures the spread in this data, measures the spread in the distribution from which we sampled. So that stays the same. The more data we sample, the more accurate our measurement of the standard deviation becomes. So this might change a little bit, but it's basically the same value we're measuring. And you may want to, you can show both. Both are relative values to show. Standard error and confidence intervals are measures of confidence. Basically, you use them when you want to show somebody how that your data set is big enough to be very confident about this mean that you've measured. And the smaller the error bar goes, the better. And the standard deviation is a measure of spread. So it doesn't tell you anything about how accurate this mean is. It tells you the data that you do have, how much it is, how widely it's clustered around this mean, which is independent of the size of your data and independent of your confidence. So let's look at this in some detail. Where does the standard error come from? What does it mean? Basically, it assumes that your data comes from a normal distribution. So it might be runtime, could be anything. We observe some values, and we sample them from a standard distribution. So this becomes our sample. So a sample, and we're interested in the mean of this sample. So we want to know what's the mean of this sample, so we compute that. And that's our outcome. This is the size of this error bar. That's our mean. But that's a random process. We could sample some more data, repeat the whole experiment, and we would get a different mean. We would get a different value here. So there's another distribution on this mean that we get, which is different. And the more data we sample here, the more confident we become about our mean, so the more like a peak this second distribution becomes. If you have a low sample, this is a student's t-distribution, and if you have a bigger sample, you can probably usually approximate this with a normal distribution. And the standard error is basically the variance of this distribution, which you can calculate as the variance of this distribution over the square of the sample size. Usually, of course, you don't have access to this value, so you estimate that from the data as well. That's basically what the standard error is. And if you know your normal distributions, if you remember your normal distributions from high school, well, for me it was high school, maybe for you it was university, you know that you can split up the percentages covered by the normal distribution in steps of the standard deviation. And if you take the interval from two standard deviations below the mean to two standard deviations above the mean, you get 95% of the probability mass of the probability distribution. And that's basically what's known as a 95% confidence interval. So if you measure some mean, you measure the standard error, you go two standard errors to the right and two standard errors to the left, that's a very good estimate of where 95% of the source of the variance of your measurement is. So you have to take a little bit of care about how you talk about confidence intervals. So just to give you that example, you can't say that the probability that the true mean is in the confidence interval, once you have your confidence interval, you cannot say that the probability that the true mean is in there is 95%. That's tempting. But the true mean is a fixed value. There's nothing probabilistic about the true mean. Because it has this, you have this distribution, which is fixed. Only the outcome when you sample from this distribution, that's random, but the distribution is fixed and its mean is also fixed. So you're not allowed to talk about the probability that the true mean has a certain value, not at least in this type of statistics. But you should say instead, if we repeat the experiment many times and we compute the confidence interval every time, then 95% of those repeats, the mean true mean will be inside the confidence interval. So the confidence interval is a statistic on the data, something we compute from the data, just like the mean itself. Finally, what does it mean when when error bars overlap? That's also good to know. It depends on whether you have standard error or a confidence interval, but basically in some cases you want to know. So we observe here a difference. We see that A is bigger than B, and we'd like to know, is that difference statistically significant? And if you use a standard error, then if there is an overlap, then that implies that there is not a statistically significant difference. If you use a confidence interval, then not seeing an overlap implies that there is a statistically significant difference. So the fact that these guys don't overlap shows that A is definitely statistically significantly bigger than B. But in both cases, the converse is not true. So if you do see an overlap here, it doesn't tell you anything. It might still be statistically significant. If you don't see an overlap here, it might still not be statistically significant. So that's the rules. And it's instructive if we have some time to think about how this applies to accuracy, because that's usually the type of metric that we report. So there we have the same thing, this true distribution, but it's not a normal distribution. So given some classifier, this is before we sample our test data. I mean, obviously our test data is given, but we can sort of pretend that we're sampling it at the moment. Before we see our test data, there is some distribution about the probability that a given instance sampled from our test data will be misclassified or classified correctly. And green here is the probability that it will be classified correctly, and red is the probability that it will be classified incorrectly. So this green value, the size of this green bar, is basically our true accuracy, which we cannot observe, but we're going to try and estimate it by sampling a lot of data, which is our test data, and computing on that test data how many misclassifications we see. So that's our true accuracy. We sample one point from our test data, and it turns out to be misclassified, and we sample another point, it's also misclassified, and so on. And if we stack them like this, we get our sample accuracy. This is our estimate, the proportion of correctly classified points of the total points in our data set. That's our sample accuracy. And this is basically the same principle as we saw with the normal distributions. We have some true distributions. We sample some data, and we get a sample accuracy. And if, in theory, hypothetically, if we were to repeat that process,
we would get a slightly different value, and there, the means of all those outputs would converge to the true accuracy. But they're not; these are not normal distributions. So also, you can just sort of say, well, if I take enough samples, then it will converge to a normal distribution. There's lots of rules, reasons why you can do that. But actually, in this case, we can look at the actual distributions. So this is called the Bernoulli distribution. Two outcomes and a probability of one outcome. Certain probability of one outcome, which is given here. So that's called the Bernoulli distribution. If you take a number of samples from a Bernoulli distribution and you measure how many of those samples are positive, that's called a binomial distribution, which looks like this. So this is sort of the expected distribution. I'm saying that wrong. This is the distribution that we get over our experiment, for which we get one sample, which is 7 correctly classified instances. So we can look at, if we want a confidence interval, we can find an interval around this value that covers 95% of the probability mass of this distribution, which looks like this, roughly. I eyeballed this, but this is roughly what the confidence interval would be. This roughly covers 95% of the probability mass. And the nice thing is you can compute this just from the test set, the size of the test set, together with the true accuracy. So if you have just those two values, it doesn't really matter what the classifier is or what method you used. So you can have a look at how the error bars, how this confidence interval expressed here as an error bar, how it changes with the size of the test set. That's quite informative. So if we have a test set of just 100, which is too low, and our accuracy is our true accuracy is 0.5, or our sample accuracy is 0.5, that doesn't usually matter very much. Our error bar is this big. So really, if we get if we measure an accuracy of 0.5, we don't really know whether it was really 0.45 or 0.55, because that's how big our uncertainty is. And it gets a little smaller if the true accuracy is bigger. So if it's 0.9, then the accuracy matters a little bit less, but it's still quite difficult to tell models apart. It's a little bit better if we have a size of 1,000, but this is still a pretty big uncertainty, because we're usually trying to tell models apart where one is 96% accurate and one is 97% accurate. That's usually the kind of difference we want to tell. So 1,000 is not enough to make that kind of judgment call. And you really need a size of 10,000 before the error bars become small enough to make that kind of call. And the nice thing is you can just compute this without looking at the classifier. So this is not normally reported, these kind of error bars, because it's sort of understood that every machine learning researcher knows about them. Because if you see that if people report, well, we use a test set of 10,000 and our accuracy is 90%, then you should sort of know for yourself, well, then the error bar is that small. It's about the size of 1%, or a little bit smaller even. Of course, not everybody does know that, so it's good to mention it occasionally, but this is why you don't usually see these kinds of values reported in machine learning research, because usually everybody reuses the same data. So the test data, the size of test data is known. Just for future references, these are the curves for the size of the confidence interval. So there are two reasons to show some statistics. One is to show confidence, which we've talked about now, to show basically to boast how big your test data is so that you're really confident about this mean that you've computed. And the other is to show spread. So if you're doing an experiment, there are multiple sources of randomness, partly from your data sampling, but also if you're doing something like a gradient descent that we talked about last Thursday, you have to initialize your parameters or something, and that's also random usually. If you're doing random search, you have lots of random steps. So there's lots of different reasons why this whole pipeline that ultimately leads to an accuracy value might be a little bit random. And quite often you also want to give an indication of that. So you can say, well, I'm very, very sure, very, very confident of this mean value, of how how precise its mean is over all these random samples, over all this randomness. But you also want to show the spread that this randomness causes. So you also want to say, well, so I'm sure this is the mean, but there is a huge variance, so you cannot be sure that you actually, if you do one of these experiments, you can actually achieve this mean, unless the variance is very small. And it's very easy if you just want to show the variance caused by algorithm initialization. You just rerun the experiment a couple of times. But usually you only have one data set, so you cannot show the spread variance caused by your data sampling. And one way to do that is to do this cross-validation. You can just sort of sample a small subset of your data set and try and experiment on that. Which leaves you with a slight bias in your estimate, but that's usually okay. But another way that especially works better than cross-validation for small data sets is called bootstrapping, where you take your data set and you resample another data set of the same size. So you're resampling with replacement. So you get some double values. That's called a bootstrap sample, which you can expect usually about 63% of your original data to end up in your bootstrap sample, and the rest will be double values. And what you can do then is you can sample a number of bootstrap samples of your data and repeat the experiment on that, and that will give you an indication of the variance of your process. So it's not ideal, but it's one way to estimate your variance. And again, we'll come back to this in week five. So I've left myself with 2 minutes for the no-frills theorem. So this is the summary of statistics. But the question is, final question, just to answer it, to talk about that very quickly. Which is the best algorithm? So we've done machine learning for more than 50 years, probably. After all this time, surely we have some idea of what the best algorithm is, and we should just throw the rest away, right? Well, there's a proper popular saying, which is that there is no free lunch, which basically means you cannot tell a priori before seeing your data what your best algorithm is. And this saying comes in two flavors, the no free lunch theorem and the no free lunch principle. So the no free lunch theorem is very interesting in what it says about basically the world. Basically, it says that if you average your performance of a given machine learning algorithm over all possible data sets, you will always get the same value. So there's no single machine learning algorithm that is better than any other machine learning algorithm if you averaged it over all learning problems, which has some interesting consequences. So imagine you're looking at two algorithms, A and B. You're thinking, well, which is better? We know how to figure out which is better. We've been talking about that for the last 2 hours. You just run it on your data and you do some cross-validation. You pick the one that does best. That's also an algorithm. It's like a meta-learning algorithm. So let's call that B. Let's call that C. And then there's a sort of perverse opposite of that, where you say we're going to do all of that, but we're going to pick the one that does worst, which is sort of absolutely unintuitive, perverse way of doing it, which we'll call D. And what the no-free lunch theorem tells us is that there are as many datasets for which C beats D as there are datasets for which D beats C. So without making any assumptions, there is absolutely no reason why this stuff that we've been talking about for the last 2 hours should work at all. So we have to make some, we are making, in saying that we're using this cross-validation approach, or this validation dataset approach, we are making implicitly some assumptions about the nature of our data. So we're basically back to the problem of induction again. We don't know why learning works. We cannot prove from first principle that machine learning works. We cannot prove it from, but it does. There are some outs, basically. There is some property of the universe that generates for us learnable data, that gives us data that we can learn from. So there are some ways of formalizing this, saying that we're getting compressible data or that the universe generates simple data. Just basically Occam's razor, if you've heard of this, the simplest explanation is usually best. Why should that be? Because for some reason the universe tends to give us data with simple explanations. Now there's a lot to be said about that, which I won't do. But one final point that I want to make is that there is also the no-free lunch principle, which you should be keep separate because no free lunch theorem says something about the universe, but it doesn't say something about. So no free lunch theorem tells us that cross validation doesn't shouldn't work in practice, but it does work in practice. The no free lunch principle is basically that no single learning method is really best, and even in practice, even though cross validation works fine in practice, you really need to try different methods when you're faced with a data set. You really need to try different methods to see which is best. You cannot say decision trees are always best. It's a mistake to think that the no-free lunch principle follows from the no-free lunch theorem. It's a mistake that's often made, so I want to separate these things in this lecture. But both are good things to be aware of. So make sure when you are faced with the data set, make sure to try different approaches. I'll skip that slide. So my final slide is a warning if you're for half of the group sessions next Thursday or next Friday, there will be a group meeting. So you will have to present about your progress, which won't be much, but just present what you have. If you have a lot of questions, then present your questions. If you have a lot of stuff that didn't work, then present what didn't work, and just try and get a healthy conversation going. So that's all I had. And I'll see you next Thursday to talk about